Starting the recording, and we are streaming now.
Welcome, everyone. This is the Community Preservation Committee, and I'd like to call this meeting to order. This is the second of two meetings where we hear from applicants for this year's round of funding. I just want the applicants who are here to present to know and be confident in the fact that the committee members have all read the applications thoroughly. And therefore, in your presentations, you need not repeat in their entirety the contents of the application. You may summarize the points you deem most important and provide to us any additional information that did not make it into the application, but you feel is relevant now. After each presentation is completed and the committee has exhausted any questions or comments that they have for the applicant, I will open that application up for public comment. Those people attending the meeting may raise your hands and you will be recognized by Andy Port and given the floor for your comment. In the past, we shoot for roughly 10 minutes per application. Although there is some flexibility since the number of applications in tonight's agenda are fewer than we usually have. With that, I'd like to take a roll call of the members present. And as soon as I find my list, I can do that. Certainly it should be committed to memory by now, right? Hey, roll call. Those in attendance, Jane Healy.
Here.
Okay, Chuck Griffin.
Here.
Don Little.
Present.
Paul Healy.
Here.
Tom O'Brien. Tom O'Brien. Mark Rosen.
Here.
Mike, if I could, I would just note, Tom appears to be connected, but not having an audio or having perhaps a microphone issue. I would just indicate to Tom and anyone else who might be having issues, there is a call-in number on the city's website and the city calendar as well that might work via phone in case you're having an audio issue.
Thanks, Andy. Glenn Richards. Okay. Don Walters. Okay. And I know from an earlier email, Don was going to be trying to call in from his car. So let's see. Okay. So we have first item on the agenda are to hear from the applicants. And the first one on the list is an application for the Market Landing Park expansion construction funding brought by the Newburyport Office of Planning and Development, requesting funding in the amount of $250,000. And I believe, Andy, are you presenting?
I am. Thank you very much, Chair and members of the committee. I will not provide a too long a presentation because I think the project, I think, speaks for itself. For the most part, the request here is essentially funding for construction of a park, the expansion of Market Landing Park on the city's downtown central waterfront. Because I think so many of you here tonight know the history of the central waterfront, at least enough of it to know how important that space is to the downtown and its unique history, and the recent efforts to dissolve the redevelopment authority. And move ahead with the park expansion. I'm not going to go over a whole lot of history of the central waterfront, but I did want to just point out that this is actually an old video that is on, somebody has posted it on YouTube. Newburyport, A Measure of Change. And I just pulled this up for a moment to note this presentation, this video from some years back, does show in this particular point in the video, does show a good amount of the central waterfront area where you can see the central embayment in blue. And that is the area that was cleared during urban renewal. You can see the sort of white, you know, clear ground there. You can see Market Square there, obviously, looking, you know, towards the land from the Merrimack River. And so that's the area we're really talking about there. And you can see in this video, I think, some of the background, the history that I think is important to this, if any of you have not seen it. So I don't intend to talk too much about that, but I just want to give an explanation of the particular project and then ask for your support in funding the project. So what I'm showing right now is this is a aerial photograph of the central waterfront looking at Market Landing Park as it is today. This is the photograph, obviously, isn't literally today, but about a year ago or so. And what you'll see in this image is you can also see in the aerial photograph here the areas where we've put in some temporary park space to address the initial expansion of that park area, which will be flared out on either side. So this is just the project site. What you'll notice is that Market Landing Park under the control of the Waterfront Trust is in the center there. And then the dotted lines are essentially showing the old former NRA, Newburyport Redevelopment Authority lots that are now under the city's control. And our obligation there is to complete the Market Landing Park expansion and reconfiguration of the remaining parking areas as part of that project. So there was a lot of other background on this that I will not bore you with, but one other thing that we did was this was the expansion of the parking areas that we did by making some temporary lawn improvements. This also is an aerial photograph of the central waterfront. And so if you'll notice in this area right here, I'm going to show you a plan in a second. That's the conceptual framework, initial conceptual framework for the park design that was developed on the city side, you know, a couple of years back. But if you'll notice that what the plan is essentially to arc this park out, flare it out from where it meets down here out to here. So this parking area right here will be adjusted accordingly. And this is, of course, interim park space in the middle. And then on the other side, the same thing, essentially. You'll see a flaring on the other side. So that is essentially where the park project is happening. And I think most of you know a lot of the history behind that, but I do want to show one or two other things that I think are helpful. So this diagram that I'm pulling up, and forgive me because I have a lot of PDFs open for tonight's meeting. This is the so-called framework plan. It's a very rough sketch plan. But it was the basis for resolving the dissolution of the NRA, agreement on how to deal with the public access to the central waterfront, limitation of development there, and ensuring that it would always be open, you know, as an open space to the public. So this framework plan is referenced in a special order or special act that was adopted by the legislature at the city council's request, you know, signed by the city council and the mayor. Requesting that the Newburyport Redevelopment Authority be dissolved. It is referenced indirectly as a secondary document as what the city's obligation is in essence in concept to complete the park. So we are following this to the best of our ability consistent with that, that act and the city council order. And this is roughly what the park will look like when it's expanded as far as its overall area. The other details are being worked out now as we go forward. What we did was we issued a, after the dissolution of the Redevelopment Authority and the conveyance essentially of the land to the city, we issued a request for proposals, RFP, to design firms. And we ended up selecting, after reviewing, I think it was 14 proposals, all from qualified firms. We decided to pick Sasaki Associates, which had actually been involved with development of some of the earlier renovation plans in the downtown. And so, and are, you know, have some institutional familiarity with this, but also have excellent experience on similar waterfront projects and downtown projects across the nation. So at any rate, we ended up picking that firm. They are under contract and they are meeting with us right now to look at their base survey plan and some of the their understanding of the design constraints that this park has, one of which is balancing things like the wings of the park, which are the green areas, and the remaining parking areas and making that efficient to preserve parking spaces, to not have as much of an impact on the downtown businesses that might use some of those spaces. But the primary purpose, I think if there's anybody who's, they might need to mute themselves. The balancing of where the bike path goes and where the parking is, but essentially this is expanding these wings on the other side of the park and then finishing what feels like it's, you know, if you're out there in the park today, you see it feels sort of like it bleeds off into the parking areas, and that will be a much more cohesive park when we're complete. So the request here is, because we're on track right now to complete the schematic phase design, meaning taking this concept plan and bringing it forward to a much more a great level of detail as to where things are going in here, geometric, alignment of things, and considering where some other focal points of the public space might be. You, for instance, do not see a way that a passageway that will be in here referred to as Ferry Wharf Way. So what you don't see in here is the complete alignment of that going through. But those details will be worked out by Sasaki in their thorough schematic design phase happening over the next 5 or 6 months. And then after that, when we have consensus over that plan, and they'll be presenting several options to us for refinement of one that we choose, we will then be moving into the final design phase, which is basically getting plans and specifications ready for bid, for public bid. And that way we can actually go out and do construction. And so knowing as project managers do how long it takes to get these things going in lead time, I wanted to make sure that we had funds available for construction when we are, quote, shovel ready. So we do have, based on the funds that were transferred to the city as part of the Redevelopment Authority dissolution, we do have, in my opinion, sufficient funds to address the design, the complete design, both schematic and complete engineering for issuance for bid for a contractor or set of contractors. But we do not have the funding sufficient for construction. Now, we are getting better estimates as part of the schematic design phase, summer to early fall. We'll have a much better idea of the number by that point. But right now we are making sure that it stays under a $5 million cap. Keep in mind that it's not just the park areas we're doing. We have to necessarily reconfigure the parking areas and upgrade them, if nothing else, aesthetically, as part of this project. So at any rate, there are some costs associated with this. There are some drainage work. There are some, there's an activities and use limitation on the site for soils under the surface that if we disturb, we'd have to dispose of with an additional cost. So at any rate, there are additional costs for a project like this. So we do not have a detailed estimate of the cost, but I can guarantee you it will cost more than the current request we have in for $250,000. And recognizing the other projects that you all have to balance out this year and other years, I did not want to be too aggressive with the request, but I do know that this project will cost a little bit more than that, and that additional funds will be needed. We will be pursuing state funds and other sources as we can for the construction. But I do want to start accumulating the funds for construction, like I said, so that we are not lingering and waiting when the design is complete. We should at that point have leveraged and aligned up the funding for construction so that the community itself does not need to wait any longer for the Market Landing Park expansion that it has waited for several decades, if you will, for those of you who know all the history. So with that, I can pull up a couple of other visuals if you want, if you have any questions or concerns, some photographs and images that might be relevant as well. And of course, if there's any questions or comments from the public, of course, as well. Other than that, I'm happy to hand it back to the chair.
Hey, committee members, any questions or comments for Andy?
I have one.
Paul.
Do you have any estimated time or date of when you might be ready to start construction?
Yeah, I would like to say next spring, but I think that's too aggressive, frankly. It's just not realistic based on my knowledge of all the different pieces that need to be lined up before then. So frankly, I think it's more likely to be the spring after that. Again, the sooner we get resolution of the schematic design plan, which at this point should be complete by the early fall, then it's just down to the consultants doing their work and greater detail to get that ready for bidding and specifications suitable for bid. And so that's a more technical side of things. Like I said, I'd love to say we're ready to get a shovel in the ground for this whole thing in the spring of next year, but I don't think that's realistic based on my experience with public design, you know, bidding and construction of projects like this.
Yeah, and then I was wondering, do you have an idea of how much money you need committed to this project, construction project, before you do begin?
Although it's possible to phase a project like this, and we may very well end up doing that for construction purposes anyway, if nothing else, to minimize impact on the downtown or people's access to the waterfront while it's under construction. We don't want to influence, you know, or impact both sides of the waterfront, say, at the same time, for instance. So we'll have to balance that out, and then that may, extend the project a little bit longer, but balance out those impacts, depending on, you know, a given construction typically happens in the warmer season when we're going to have our bigger traffic, for visitors. But we could phase it. And then, so, you know, there is possibility of doing things earlier, you know, on one piece rather than others, but typically we have all the funding lined up and then have one bidding done with one contractor to oversee. So for that reason, we typically would want all those funding sources lined up in advance. The one exception might be that if we apply for state grants and it's on a reimbursement basis, technically we don't have those funds in hand, but they're committed through essentially a grant or contract with the state for reimbursement. But in essence, that is the equivalent of the same situation where we have secured the funds. We are not able to enter into a contract with a contractor for projects like this without having those funds appropriated by the city council or having them otherwise available. So,
Tom O'Brien, you have a question?
Yes, on the revenue, NRA revenues, how much is available? How much was available to you?
Oh yeah, thank you. That's a good question. So I think I forget off the top of my head, but it was somewhere around $600,000. And so we have committed to, I think it's 134,000 of that right now in the schematic design phase with Sasaki Associates. We will obviously need to complete the final design portion, which will be a little bit more complex because of the civil engineering work and the licensed site professionals and others that are needed for that work. And then that will take a little bit more detailed time, of course. So that will cost, a little bit more than that. But that is why I say I think we are certainly within what we need for the design phase, just unfortunately not enough for the construction.
Okay, the other thing is, how much do you estimate to get from the downtown parking program revenues?
For this particular project?
Yeah.
That, unfortunately, I cannot say at this point because that will be up to the city council. There is a requirement, and I will defer to the finance director on this sort of thing, but there is a requirement in the dissolution of the NRA as far as revenues coming from parking on the central waterfront going towards design, construction, and maintenance of the waterfront park. So there's an already a sort of statutory requirement there that there's an allocation, if you will, towards the design, construction, and maintenance of the park. How much the city council might decide to pull from, yearly revenues from downtown parking or other sources, I would have to defer to the council on. I have initiated a request to the trust fund commission for an old fund. I forget the name of it off the top of my head, apologies, but a fund that was set aside some time ago that could provide up to $1 million, but 750 to $1 million towards this project because it was for improvements, sort of public improvements or park improvements, if you will, along the Merrimack River and the waterfront. So this is perfectly aligns with the purposes of that trust fund. So I can't say definitively what the council will pull from as far as other funds, but we will certainly be pursuing state funds, a so-called park grant, mm-hmm. and other sources outside the city as well. And then at that point, it will be down to presumably multi-year, hopefully with your support, multi-year CPC funds and other funds that the council may wish to designate for this project.
Thank you.
Jane Healy, you have a question.
Andy, you alluded to this a little earlier, and you know more than most people, if not everyone, the difficulty that the city has had to develop this area and to make it the park. And so I'm wondering, in your opinion anyway, what makes this attempt or effort different? Like, why? how is this actually going to happen? I've been here a long time and I've heard a lot about the waterfront. And so, you know, for us to set aside, you know, start building fund or, you know, recommending funding, I want to make sure that something is different, you know, some kind of assurance that this is actually going to happen.
Yeah, thank you. That's actually a great question. I appreciate you asking that. What I actually wanted to pull up, and I apologize for just needing a minute to pull up the right document. But the reason for that actually, and it's actually right on target. I apologize, I'm just still looking for this. There we go. The reason for that is actually not thanks to me really, but thanks to the city council and the mayor and the state legislature for this, which is the act to dissolve the redevelopment authority and transfer its lands to the city of Newburyport. That was preceded by action by the city council and the mayor and I'm just going to flip to the next page of this to show you one of the excerpts from section 7 of that. That's because the mayor and the city council finally, after so many years of as you point out, controversy over the central waterfront and debate over what will happen there, coming to resolution. And this was this particular language from the act itself, which calls for the city to design and construct this park, references a city council order, which is really where the consensus was built. And that is, and I'm just showing you an excerpt of that that's relevant, calls for, and this is why I say it extends back from the statute now. The statute references the city council order, which references this policy document, which is essentially a consensus over settlement of these issues so that we can build the bigger park and settle the so-called way is the final way, Ferry Wharf Way, and remaining public access to the waterfront, quote, in perpetuity. So so it's actually because of that work that was done, you know, a couple of years ago at this point, you know, we had to wait for the legislature's approval to dissolve the redevelopment authority. But it was that consensus building that allows, I think, us to now have confidence that spending money on the both the design and the construction is well worth our efforts, because I do consider it to be the flagship park of the city. You know, regardless of whether it's under the Parks Commission or the Waterfront Trust, it's still the flagship, you know, park of the city, in my opinion. And so I think that the community certainly waited for it. There's broad consensus over seeing this project completed. And therefore, I don't feel that it would be premature at this point. So thank you.
That's great. And I just wanted to make sure I understood in terms of existing or current funding. It sounds like, am I right that I understand 600,000 that you have right now from the NRA, and the schematic was 134,000. So that difference, you're confident that will get you to get us to the end of the design phase, the final design phase. Is that correct?
That's correct. Based on my experience with projects like this and the initial, you know, the numbers have been somewhat consistent with what we'd expected. We actually, I won't go through the numbers with you for the schematic design phase, but we had a spread of numbers between the roughly 14 proposals we got. And there was a lot of consistency towards the end of the contract that we ended up approving, which was 134,000. We actually had a few that were quite substantially more than that, which we weren't interested in anyway, based on the ranking, but it would have been exorbitantly expensive for just a schematic phase. So I do think that we're, you know, certainly with spending, you know, 134 for this schematic design phase to get the detail we need beyond that framework plan, so-called framework plan. I do think we have plenty sufficient at this point to finish the design and permitting of this project, leaving then hopefully whatever dollar amount is left in the account then for construction. But like I said, it just won't be enough to complete this project based on its scale.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions from any committee members? Andy, I've got a quick question for you. I don't know if you can answer it, but I know you mentioned that you've got a $5 million cap. Is that the order of magnitude that people are thinking about for total costs?
I guess what I would say with that is, based on the order of magnitude of the project and some prior experience, that's a number that we thought was reasonable. We actually discussed this with the city council when we had the original appropriation not long ago for the contract with Sasaki. And we had agreement at that point that we would cap and we'd have Sasaki hold to a design cost of $5 million. So we'll see what they come back with for the estimates and we'll refine from there. But that is, we wanted to make sure that there was a cap on what this sort of thing would cost. Now, we have to keep in mind, of course, that you know we have to stretch those dollars and do as much as we can to make this project fit in the downtown. There's, as you can see with you know some of these images here, you know this is Summerby's Way. This is the type of quality, obviously, that we would want to see in the new park. So we'll have to see where the numbers end up falling, but we do not want the project to be too expensive. And frankly, I'd like to see it less than that, but we'll have to see where it comes out. And like I said, the park, we cannot ignore the parking areas and sort of, you know, just push them back and leave them as gravel. They have to be, landscaped or blended in so that they do not appear as an aesthetic backdrop to the park as they sort of have for a while, historically.
And in your current schedule, when do you expect to have the heart numbers in from bidders? For the construction.
Oh, for the construction. Yeah. So at this point, I mean, we would not probably be ready to go to bid until, the summer to, fall basically of next year. You know, this is based on my, experience over the years with these type of projects and the different factors involved with this one. And so, I'd love to see it go faster in an ideal world. If everything was in my direct control, that would be feasible maybe, but, aside from the funding, but there's lots of other pieces aside from the funding even that need to be dealt with between now and then. That being said, I would say probably the summer to fall of next year is reasonable. And then allowing us to actually get the shovels in the ground the following spring. It's possible for things to happen sooner, but that all depends on, funding and things like that. And that is why I have assumed a multi-year CPC request, similar to what you have certainly seen from Jordy over the years for the Culper City Rail Trail. And I think that project has certainly benefited the city and is we can think of it as a perpetual benefit to the public. I think of this park as being the same. And so I definitely think it's worth a multi-year effort. I would have asked for more if I thought that was reasonable, but I do know that there are other requests this year, and and I know that they're also worthy projects. So, I appreciate whatever support you have for this project, whether it's this round or any others. I may, of course, very well be coming back for additional funds next year, but my goal is to pursue even outside the city state funds as much as we can secure any of those.
Yes, I think with projects passed, if you've got construction funding committed in hand, that's a nice highlight to put in your applications for state or federal funds too. So,
agreed. Thank you.
Okay. Another question from Jane.
Switching gears a little bit from the current conversation, and I assume this is the case, but Andy, could you confirm if the RFP addresses sea level rise, storm surge, adaptive landscape, just to make sure this will be here
for the long term? Yeah, thank you, Jane, for asking that question. That's a great question, too. We did actually call for that specifically in the request for proposals, which the scope of services that I put together for the RFP became the basis for the scope of work for the contract, obviously. So that is in there. I worked with and talked with the city engineer about that. I've been working with the resiliency committee and others, and we've talked about that with I think that's come up in other contexts as well. So we definitely have that as a consideration for them. And I'm happy to elaborate on that, but yes, definitely.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the committee?
I have a question, it's an observation. Happy to see this happen, Andy. It's exciting. Looking at the schematic fee and thinking what that would represent of the total fee, I think that you're going to be looking at fees of $600,000 or more, that'd be my guess. And if you take that as a percentage of what the work's likely to cost, there's a pretty tried and true formula. I think it'll be well over $5 million, but I think it is well worth it. But I don't think, knowing Sasaki's approach, and I have some knowledge of it, it's a back and forth iterative approach with the community. I think this will take at least 2 years, at least, to design before you're talking about putting it out to the bidders. But that does, I'm not trying to throw cold water on it. I just think it's a lot of work and expensive, and the prices are really going up rapidly right now in construction across the board.
Thank you. Yeah, we'll definitely do our best to keep the cost down. You know, that's one of our fiduciary duties, and I definitely appreciate, you know, time to share that sentiment. But we'll definitely do our best to make sure that it's both a quality project and, you know, under budget, so to speak.
Okay, if there are no other questions from the committee, Andy, if you see any hands raised from members of the public, you can recognize them now. Andy, are there any hands raised from the public?
I am not seeing any at this time.
Okay.
Not that we necessarily need to have any, but I don't see any hands raised at this time.
Okay.
Okay.
Good. I guess to check that box and move on. Then. All right. Next on the list is the application for the YMCA project at Hillside. YWCA project at Hillside, brought by the YWCA of Greater Newburyport, requesting funding in the amount of $50,000. So is John here? John
Sheehan? Yeah.
Okay, John.
Good. And Andy, if you've got some slides for me. There we go.
I do. Yep. Sorry, I have so many PDFs open for everybody tonight. I apologize. It took a second. There it is.
Okay. Thank you again for the opportunity to talk about the YWCA at Hillside. This is a project that we brought before the committee many years ago, and you were kind enough to fund in the amount of $150,000. And so what I thought I'd do is just remind you a little bit about the project to begin with. So next slide, please. This does have, it does meet the requirements, you know, under the Newburyport Master Plan in a number of different ways. And this project is designed to be net positive. So it's actually going to produce more energy than it uses. It's designed to address transportation issues by being located next to a bus line, next to the rail station, easy ability for people to walk downtown. And then it's going to promote bicycle use by having a very large bicycle storage shed. Next slide, please. So it's a 10-unit lodging house. We're going to have 10 single individuals. Each room is small and cannot accommodate more than one person. Six units are for people below 30% of the area median income. And I thought I'd convert that into dollars to make it a little bit more understandable for you. So for six of the folks, their income has to be below $28,200. And we actually have subsidies to help them pay their rent in that income bracket. And then we have four units for people whose income is below $47,000. That's considered 50% of the area median. One of the units is wheelchair accessible, and one of the units is for sensory disabilities, and two of the units will be reserved for homeless individuals. Next slide, please. This is a turnkey project, so the YWCA is purchasing the completed building from Hillside Center for Sustainable Living, and that is why a lot of this has been kind of beyond the control of the YWCA. There were a number of delays in the planning of the project. The building is also what's considered a passive house design. So in theory, you don't have to add heating or, you know, mechanical heating or mechanical air conditioning. We actually will have those units available to make sure that it always meets the Board of Health requirements. But in designing the building of this nature, most housing structures that are passive house are designed to have doors open, you know, inside the building. And it's just not designed for a lodging house. And so meeting some of the technical demands of having very small rooms with all the doors closed, with so many people living in such a small unit, created a lot of planning problems, technical problems for the project. And then we were set to go about a year ago and the pandemic hit. And And the reason that cost us about a year was because there was a period of several months where construction could not start. And by the time we were about allowed to begin construction again, our project got pushed down on the list again. And so it took a little bit of time to get everything back organized. Over the course of the years, the cost of it has gone up by $330,000. Again, some of that is to address the technical nature of the project, and some of it is just inflation over that time. Next slide, please. We do have quite a bit of, sorry, the formatting on this isn't perfect. We do have $1.5 million already confirmed, both through the private donations, private foundations, DHCD, CPA committee, and a bank loan. But there's still a gap of $330,000. Next slide, please. We've got additional funding sources that we're reaching out to. Franklin Square House is very interested in this project. They would have allowed us to apply in December of 2020, but unfortunately, they have redirected their funds or in that cycle for the pandemic. I've been encouraged to apply in December 2021. And again, they've already reviewed the project and they're very excited about it. It doesn't guarantee funding, but at least there's a strong interest on their part. We submitted an application to People's United Bank, hopeful for that. Federal Home Loan Bank, we applied to them in July of last year and we were denied. And the reason that we were denied was because Federal Home Loan is a bank, and they loan money, and they want us to borrow money. And the amount of money that we were borrowing was too small in relationship to the amount of the loan that we were, I'm sorry, the amount of money that we were borrowing was too small in relationship to the size of the grant that we were asking for. So part of what we're hoping for in this application of $50,000 is to reduce the amount of grant that we would then have to ask from Federal Home Loan Bank that will increase our scoring. We also learned that there were federal earmarks available, and we submitted a request to the Congressman's office. They are still in the process of reviewing that. Next slide, please. Progress is actually being made now. Hillside Center for Sustainable Living hired L.D. Russo as the general contractor. L.D. Russo was the contractor that built 11 Market Street in Newburyport, and also the residences at Salisbury Square. They have a lot of additional experience doing affordable housing, and they also have some experience doing passive house design. So construction's already begun. We've submitted all our management documents to DHCD, and we are working with them to actually get a closing date. The reason we're doing that now is because it takes DHCD sometimes as long as 6 months to assign a closing date. Next slide, please. And again, we're seeking $50,000 from the CPA. You've already generously given us $150,000 towards the project, but we're hoping that with this additional funds to get a better score on our FHLB grant. And then final slide. We actually are building it. This picture was taken a couple weeks ago. It's my understanding that the framing on the third floor is already complete as well. So thank you very much for your time, and I'll answer any questions if I can.
Hey, do I have questions or comments from the committee?
I have a question. Mm-hmm. You started construction and yet you're short $330,000. What happens if you don't get that raised?
We do have an agreement with Hillside Center for Sustainable Living to give us a 0% interest loan for up to 2 years to cover the amount. We'll still have to raise the additional money at some point, but we've got a little bit of time to accomplish that.
John, this is Mike Doucette. I've got a question. The gap you now have, is that related directly to changes you have encountered in your project for this building and this plot of land in the greater project, and not from increases in the other part of this build out?
Yes, that is correct. This is cost increase just for this project. One of the big cost increases was they decided to bring LD Russo into the project and have them serve as general contractor instead of having Hillside build it at their own pace. We were excited about that because we knew that would accelerate the construction of the project. But that did add quite a bit of cost.
Okay. Any other questions from the committee? Okay, I don't see any. Andy, do you have any members of the public with hands raised?
We do, actually. We have a few. So first one is only identified as Chapa. So perhaps if you could just identify your name for the record.
Hi, sorry about that. that's my work picture. My name is Karen Wiener. I'm a resident at 7 Lincoln Street. I'm also on the Affordable Housing Trust. And I just want to speak in favor of the project. There's a tremendous need for affordable housing in Newburyport. And I think the Y has done a great job, has a great track record. So does J.D. Russo. So I just wanted to support their application.
Thank you, Karen.
And the next person we have is Kristen Wolf, I think it's pronounced.
Hi there. Thank you for taking my comment. My name is Kristen Wolf. I live at 1 Merrimack Street in number 21 in downtown Newburyport. And I'd also like to voice my support for this project. The entire Hillside project is one that is very necessary for Newburyport as far as adapting to climate change and moving forward on climate issues. The idea of the social justice and the equality issues are very important that the Y gets this funding as well. Thank you.
Okay, next person is Mio Young.
Hi, my name is Mio Young and I live in Newburyport. I am so happy that the YW is building this much needed affordable housing here in Newburyport where things have gotten so expensive. And I support this request. Thank you.
Thank you. Next person, Cintra Warden. And just for the clarification, you'll have to unmute on your end as well.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. So my name is Cintra Warden. I live on Lowe Street in Newburyport, and I support this $50,000 donation. I feel it's very important what the YWCA is doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Next person is Madeline Nash.
Hi. Thanks, Andy. I live at 19 Arlington Street in Newburyport, and I'm also a member of the Newburyport Affordable Housing Trust. I just wanted to say briefly that I'm very supportive of the WISE application. This is such a unique opportunity that we have, and they've done a great job of assembling a variety of funding sources. It's always hard to pull together all the different resources, but I think that this additional request they're submitting is modest, and it's a great opportunity for the city to address its housing needs. Thank you.
Thank you. Next person is Jeanette.
Okay. Now, can you hear me now?
We can, yes. Thank you.
I sound like the ad. So my name is Jeanette Isabella. I'm a Newburyport resident, and I completely support this additional funding for the Y. And I just want to say that I agree with some of the comments that have already been made, and I want you to know that I join with many others who believe in the need for affordable housing in Newburyport. So I completely support this. Thank you.
Thank you. Next person is Michael Lane.
Yeah. Good evening. Hi, it's Michael Lane, number 11 Jefferson Court. the Y has done amazing work throughout the community over in Salisbury. All I can say is this is a continuation of fantastic effort, design, and execution, and I support it.
Okay, thank you. It looks like, Chair, that's all the hands that have been raised for public comment.
Thank you. Did that create any further questions from the committee? No? Okay, thank you, John. And we can
appreciate it.
Move on to our next project. This is a project entitled Emergency Rental Assistance Program / General Rental Assistance Program, brought to us by the Newburyport Affordable Housing Trust, requesting a grant in the amount of $200,000. Madeline, are you presenting?
Well, I think Karen Wiener is going to kick us off.
Okay.
Yep, I'm going to start, if that's okay.
Sure.
I first want to just apologize that you're seeing my work logo. You know, the life with Zoom right now, I just couldn't figure out how to put my personal picture and name there. But again, I apologize.
Quite a ride, it happens to all of us.
Yeah. One day we'll all be able to meet in person again. Anyway, so my name is Karen Wiener once again, and I'm with the Newburyport Affordable Housing Trust, and we are applying to the committee for $200,000. $110,000 is basically reimbursement for an emergency rental assistance program that we have been running, or we have funded Pettingill House to run for us, I should say, since June. And then $90,000 for us to start up a little bit different kind of emergency rental or rental assistance program. And I'm gonna start by telling you a little bit about the current program during COVID. I'm gonna turn it over to Sierra Partland from Pettingill House to tell you a little bit about the results of the program. And finally, Madeline Nash will talk about the new program that we're proposing. So to tell you a little bit about the Emergency Rental Assistance Program, it's not something the Trust had ever thought about before, but obviously when COVID hit, we knew people were losing their jobs, facing all kinds of economic hardship, and we certainly didn't want to see people lose their homes as well. We were involved with a quasi-state organization, the Massachusetts Housing Partnership, that gave out guidance on how local communities could start their own emergency rental assistance programs. I believe there's something like 27 around the state. It might be 37, I forget. But Newburyport has been one of them, and the Trust was happy to use our funds to help folks, particularly lower income folks who might be facing potential eviction and hardship and unable to pay their rents, both for them to stabilize their housing. And in many cases, people live in, you know, two families with a smaller landlord who in turn would not be able to pay their mortgage. So it was really for economic stability all around. The program has been very successful thanks to Pettingill House. They have administered it for us, and they'll tell you a little bit more about the folks who it has helped. Basically, we took the money from our funds, from the trust funds, because we needed to do something quickly, obviously, in the face of an emergency. And so we're looking to the CPC to reimburse those funds for us. It's basically $100,000 for the program itself, for the money that has gone out or will go out to Newburyport residents in need, and $10,000, which is what we had agreed to pay Pettingill House for administering the program. So I'll have the three of us present and then we'll open up to questions, or does anyone want to ask me questions right now? Okay, why don't we continue then? Sierra, are you there to talk a little bit about the households that we've helped?
Yes, I am.
Great.
Hi, I'm the Director of Development and Programs at the Pettingill House. So through this program, we've been able to assist 27 Newburyport households that have been impacted by COVID with a total of $78,811 of rental assistance funds. In addition to that, we have 7 applications that are pending, additional verifications. So we expect that we will be expending the rest of these funds So among those families it was 30 adults, 20 children, and 8 senior citizens included in those households. So we've been taking applications, screening applicants, and administering the funds for this program. So although there's been a moratorium on evictions, rent doesn't stop accruing, and these families will still be responsible for making their rent payments, regardless of any hardships due to the pandemic, which we all know has been a challenging time. So the Newburyport Rental Assistance Program has been essential to making this more manageable for families during a difficult time and enabling them to keep up with the payments and ultimately stay in their homes in Newburyport. So we've had several applicants who lost their jobs due to the pandemic and couldn't keep up with their rent payments. We had a single parent who had to leave their job to stay home with the kids during remote learning. So there are a variety of circumstances at play, and this has been a tough year. So this program has helped alleviate some of these hardships during a difficult time. If there are any questions for me, I'm happy to answer them, or I can pass it on to Madeline.
I think you can pass it on to Madeline.
Okay, great. Thanks, everyone. Pettingill has done a tremendous job, and we're so grateful for the help that they were able to provide in a very quickly, I must say. And I just wanted to reiterate what Karen said about, you know, the trust had never envisioned running an emergency rental assistance program previously. The funds that we have in our control have been accumulated over the years, often from CPA commitments. And the goal of the majority of our funds are to be available to assist once we have a new development initiative, such, you know, we're waiting for an affordable development project where, you know, it's very likely that the city would need to provide matching funds. So we are holding on to some funds for that use. We also have funds for down payment assistance to first-time home buyers. So again, we're looking to be reimbursed for this exceptional situation that we were faced with. And I really do think it's pretty amazing that we've been able to help so many households, and we have, I think, 7 more pending applications. So it's really pretty remarkable. In addition, we've been thinking about what are the other needs that we could be responding to. While we're waiting for a new affordable housing development initiative to come to Newburyport, we are mindful of the fact that there are probably other needs that have to do with serving Newburyport households that currently live here, or possibly people who are looking to move into, to become a Newburyport resident, or who maybe are looking to return to Newburyport. So one of the things we thought about is, could we help with the project that is just renting up now, known as Newburyport Crossing, over near the train station. It's being developed by Minco Properties. I'm sure you're familiar, or you noticed it. And we were thinking about the fact that there are 19 units there that are earmarked as affordable rental units. And it's still expensive to move in there. The rents are not as low as they perhaps could be. For example, a 2-bedroom rent is $1,800 a month. The reason why the rents are kind of high, they're set at 80% area median income, but rents in Newburyport are set by a regional fair market rent. And so, you know, in some ways they're, I think, a little inflated for Newburyport, but these rents are set by the state, and they are what they are. But in any case, if a tenant is faced with putting down first last in security. It could be as much as $5,400 for one of those two bedroom apartments. And so we were thinking, you know, maybe we should design a program around helping lower income tenants move into some of these apartments that we are looking forward to being offered on the, in the market here in Newburyport. There's 19 affordable units at the current building developed by Minco. And then there's, we believe there's gonna be another 19 affordable units at the next building that they're going to be developing. So we have come up with this program. We're still fleshing it out. But what we're envisioning is that these, this rental assistance would be, again, limited to something like first, last, and security, perhaps just last month's rent and security. And it would be limited to deed restricted affordable units rather than just any rental unit in Newburyport. Although we're, you know, still sort of trying to figure out the program parameters, what makes most sense. And we are also envisioning that Pettingill House would help us to administer this program as well. You know, we're sort of seeing this as a way to help open up the market in Newburyport to folks who just might have a hard time moving in and covering those costs. So that's it in a nutshell. Happy to take questions.
Thank you, Madeline. Jane Healy, you have a question.
Thanks, Madeline. I have actually two questions, one on each program. For the emergency rental assistance, it looks like it will provide 3 months worth of rent. And I'm wondering, is that enough? Like, do you find that helpful in terms of if rent is accruing and it's been accruing for a year, basically, is 3 months enough? And I guess if you've heard of, are there other programs on the state level that are going to address the longer term issues or sort of basically just what your thoughts are on that?
Yeah, I can start answering that. And then maybe Sierra could join in. There is a state program for emergency rental assistance, and it has been increased with some federal funds. It takes time to access, and not everyone who is eligible for the Newburyport program is necessarily eligible for that one, but there is some overlap. So for some folks where 3 months is not enough, there is hopefully enough assistance otherwise. But I think for a lot of people, they had some savings, you know, they could go for some time, but to go 3 months was way too much. But Sierra, maybe you know more specific examples.
Yeah, so as we took applications, we were really screening for, you know, a lot of needs. And we do have other funding sources that we can assist people with in addition to the Newburyport Rental Assistance. So, you know, we were pointing people to programs like RAFT as well that has funding available for rental assistance. Although, you know, 3 months may not be enough to sustain, we also had other funding sources, and it is true that, you know, there is ongoing assistance available as well. But these funds were available on an emergency basis, and really, as was already said, could be accessed more quickly.
Okay, thank you. And my second question on the general rental assistance program, I know you're still developing it, but I was wondering your thoughts on the security deposit, if that once someone moved out of the apartment, would the fund or the program basically get those, the security deposit back?
Right, it's a good question. I mean, I envision this as having funds that are sort of recirculating as, you know, hopefully people repay, we reclaim the security deposit. It could be invested to help another household. That's the intent. Of course, you never really know.
Right. Thank you.
Any other questions from committee members?
Yeah, Mike,
I have a question. Yes. Yes, Paul.
Yeah, you know, I remember when the Affordable Housing Trust first began, and we were very supportive of that because we figured that we could allocate money to the Affordable Housing Trust and they would know best where it should be used. And I'm just wondering if, you know, you're applying for this, you know, 100,000 for the emergency rental, 90,000 for the general rental program, and 10,000, I think, for, but anyway, do they, when we allocate this, would we allocate it specifically for those programs, or would we just allocate it in general to the Affordable Housing Trust and let them decide what's working at that given time?
I'm not sure I fully understand the question, sorry, but I've right now, at least what we're asking for this particular, and I will say that the committee's been tremendously supportive of us, which we really appreciate, and of affordable housing. It's been a good partnership. This particular application, we're asking specifically to be reimbursed for the current COVID emergency rental assistance program, and then have some funds to start another emergency rental assistance program for people, you know, the way Madeline described, trying to move into the city or retain housing in the city.
Karen, if I may, this is Andy. I think if I'm not mistaken, Paul might be asking whether or not there's some desire or interest in having a more unrestricted allocation to the trust that would determine if necessary more modifications without having to come back to the CPC or the council, I guess, just based on the fact that I think that, Paul, am I mistaken?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think we'd be fine with that.
We'll take whatever you want to give us.
Right. Yeah. No. It seems to me that that your group has a very good track record, and that it's working as we all hoped it would.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any other questions from the committee?
Thanks.
Seeing none, Andy, if we have any members of the public that want to weigh in.
Let's find out. I guess we'll give it a moment, I guess. I'm not seeing any hands, Chair.
Okay, thank you. Just a general comment. It appears to me that it's a wonderful administrative partnership that's happened between the trust and Pettengill House to be able to dive into this need and get it met. So that's the way it has to happen. There's a one side that knows how to administer and they've done it before, and there's another side that knows how to get the funding. So,
right, we're very grateful for Pettengill's assistance.
Yes. Okay. No other questions or comments. Then I can thank the presenters on this one, and we can move on.
Thank you.
Okay. Next, we have the Custom House Maritime Museum door restoration project brought to us by the Newburyport Maritime Society, requesting $43,831. And whoever is presenting, is it Greg or is it Doug?
I believe we have Doug, Greg. Okay. And I'm not sure.
Yeah, Joan Whitlow.
We have Joan here as well.
Joan's here, okay. Okay, you have the floor.
This is Doug. Thank you, Chairman DeSette and members of the committee. Just by way of a brief intro, you have the application, of course. Our project consists of two components. one of which is the restoration of the front door, the red front door on the building. And this has been on our radar screen for a number of years. We wanted to do it in 2012 and 13 and didn't have enough money to do it at that point in time. The second component is the installation of a new north door or rear door on the building. The existing doors on the rear of the building are in terrible shape and not historically accurate at all. That's the two components in a nutshell. I want to introduce Greg Colling, who developed the plans for this. Greg has been with us for a number of years as chair of our building committee. He's a preservation architect in the greater Newburyport area, worked most recently, in addition to our work, on the Amesbury Carriage Museum. Some of you are familiar with that, I assume. So Greg, I'd like to turn it over to you if you'll walk the committee through the project.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Hi, my name's Greg Colling. And if you could start with the first slide, just want to provide a brief introduction of our project and give you an update on some of the other work that we've been doing with CPC funding. In 2018, we requested $100,000 for a slate roof replacement project. That work was completed in January of 2020, and we were reimbursed for that work by the CPC in February of this year. In 2019, we requested CPC funds for a feasibility study for interior climate control system. And there was a $75,000 award for that work. And we recently just received, actually the end of last week, we received a thermal envelope analysis report from the engineers that are working with us. And my firm is working on an architectural conservation assessment. We're updating a report that was prepared in 2004 to create a report that outlines the baseline conditions for the building and identifies all the architectural elements in their condition. So we're currently working on that. We have a draft under review currently, and we'll be wrapping that up hopefully this week. And also we had an amended and restated preservation restriction that was recorded in at the beginning of the year in January, and that allowed us to receive the matching funds for the slate roof project. And currently we received approval from the Newburyport Historic Commission for this project, for the south door restoration on Water Street and the north door on the water side of the building. You could go to the next slide. I can also review the funding requests that we're making for this project. We've had estimates prepared by C2MG Builders and KSD. They're a company in Boscawen, New Hampshire, and they do institutional door restoration, and they also fabricate custom doors. So for the south door, we have a cost estimate of $23,000. And the scope of work includes removing the doors, putting up a temporary door in their place, and having the doors shipped up to New Hampshire, and then they'll be restored. The doors were restored in 2003, and they were they used Abitron epoxy. The doors have received a lot of abuse over the years. There's different hardware that's been put on them. and the perimeter of the doors are unsealed. The hardware doesn't function properly for life safety purposes for exiting the building. And the hardware, several items of the hardware are not functioning. For example, the thumb latch hole that you see on the outside of the door is not, has no thumb latch. So we're proposing to replace the hardware with new period hardware. There'll be a cast iron rim lock, which would have been appropriate to the history of the building, on the interior with a lever that people will be able to safely egress the building. And we're replacing the flush bolts and putting in new perimeter weather seals to prevent heat loss from the building. And then also we're going to be doing some work, hopefully, to preserve the portico. Currently the roof is leaking and the wood ceiling above is damaged. And we'd like to replace the bullet light fixture up there with a more appropriate decorative light fixture. Next slide, please. These are photographs of the interior condition of the south doors. On the left, you can see light daylight through at the top and the bottom of the doors. The left bottom hinge, there's a threaded bolt that was put in there temporarily. The original pin for that hinge is missing. There's a flush bolt at the top of the right-hand door that is inaccessible. The doors are 9 feet high, and there's a 6-inch slide bolt at the top. So we're proposing to put in a Cremone bolt on that side that can be operated from a person standing at the door. And also you'll see there's a residential apartment lock that was put on the door during the 1973 to 75 building restoration, and it still remains there with the utility pole on the left. On the right side, on the right photo, you can see the interior aluminum storefront doors that were added to prevent heat loss in the building. Those doors, the weather strips have failed, and the right-hand door leaf, the door closer at the top is broken, and we'd like to replace that and make those, restore those to functionality. Next slide, please. And these are the architectural drawings that specify the work. We also have a company from Delaware that does fabricates custom reproduction hardware, and they're the company that we hope to use to make the cast iron rim lock and to fabricate the missing hinge pin, and then put in new bolts to secure the doors in place. Next slide. And then on the water side, these are the surviving aluminum storefront doors that were installed in 1973. The architects that worked on the restoration, Perry Dean Rogers and Stewart, they originally had designed more historically appropriate wood doors, and for several reasons that was cut from the budget, and they put in this set of doors with Lexan side lights that ended up rotting, and those were replaced. They were removed in 2003, and they reframed the side lights and covered them with plywood and painted them. And a couple other things about this door, the pair of doors here, that's a 5-foot pair of doors, so each door leaf is 30 inches. They don't meet egress requirements for safe exiting of the building, even though the basement of the building is approved for 50 person occupancy by the Newburyport Fire Department. So we're proposing to replace those doors with new custom wood doors that would be more appropriate We did some research. The New London Custom House and the New Bedford Custom House had rear doors with V-groove, tongue and groove board faces on them, and we're proposing to do the same thing here. Again, this door also, the hardware has failed on it. It doesn't, it's not particularly secure. It there's heat loss through the door, and it's been the hardware's been modified many times. And another important element of replacing these doors is that we'll be putting in a bulkhead, a removable bulkhead, that will protect the building and collections and the basement level from storm surge and flooding. And the cost estimate for the door replacement here is $33,000. Next slide, please. These are on the left side, that's a close-up of the interior condition of the doors. You can see the closers are blocked with 2x4s, and you can see light through at the threshold. When you get heavy wind-driven rain, it soaks the floor in the vestibule there. The other piece of the scope of work here is that we're proposing to take away the interior storefront vestibule doors, which you can see on the right image. The doors are in the open position and they don't provide, there's not an adequate distance between the two pairs of doors for safe egress from the building. So we're recommending removing those. Next slide, please. And again, here's an architectural drawing outlining the scope of work. So these are the new custom V-groove board doors. They'll be fabricated from mahogany, and they'll have a new paint finish that is high gloss and resistant to water. There'll be a new weather seal, and there'll be new panic devices on the doors and new closers, so they'll function properly and safely. Next slide, please. So just to summarize, the exterior door project is intended for both the south door and the north door to increase safety in the building for visitors, and to provide a more secure openings on the north and south for collection security, and also to minimize heat loss and reduce the building's carbon footprint, and then to provide resiliency and adaptation in the face of climate change, and to correspond to the Newburyport Climate Resiliency Plan, and secure the collections in the building from flooding. And finally, just to, this is part of the work that we're doing with assessing the climate, the feasibility of introducing new climate control in the building. This is part of the overall work that we've been doing over the years to make this building watertight and prevent heat loss. And finally, the doors on the rear side of the building will be an improvement now that, looking back at what Andy was discussing regarding the Market Landing Park expansion, this facade will really be much more important from the park. It will be more like Water Street side, and hopefully there'll be a lot more people enjoying that space behind the building. So I think that's it. Happy to answer any questions, and thank the commission for your time and consideration for this project.
Thank you, Greg. Any questions or comments from the committee? Tom O'Brien.
Yes. My question is, we don't have enough funding to fund all the proposals. I was wondering which door you would like to have be done first if funds have to be cut.
Oh, the north door, absolutely, because it's the building right now is vulnerable to flooding. And the right now that door threshold is 2 feet below the flood elevate, the design flood elevation for the Merrimack River. So we'd like to reduce the hazard to that building and preserve the building.
Thank you.
Jane Healy.
Got two questions. Greg, I might have heard wrong. I'm hoping that I did. Did you say the roof is leaking or the roof was leaking?
No. The roof is no longer leaking.
Okay, good. That's what I do here. I had a heart attack there for a second.
No, that's the purpose of the slate roof replacement project. The roof was replaced in its entirety with a new mottled green and purple slate roof, and all of the flashings were replaced. The first 3 feet of the roof on each side were, they put down ice and water shields, and the rest of the roof has 30-pound building felt, and we worked with an incredible slate roofing contract, a third-generation slate roofing contractor.
Okay, it's, great. That is good to hear.
With the work that was done. The recent work that we've done to prevent water infiltration in the building, I think, has made a huge difference. The masonry repointing project that we had done in 2013 on the Water Street facade and then on the west facade in the photograph has made a real difference in reducing water vapor and bulk water transmission through the facades, and you know that if in the past had damaged the interior finishes of the galleries. We still have moisture transmission issues in the building that we're continuing to address with current planning.
Okay. Well, I'm glad that things are improving. My second question was for the north door, the rear door. Is that incorporated? I know it's from 1973, so it might not have even been addressed, but in the preservation restriction, are there going to be any complications with changing that door or any requirements?
Well, it was approved by the Historic District Commission. So we have approval to proceed with the work. It's the doors that were installed in 1973 were installed as a way to complete the project. The original contractor that that started the restoration project defaulted, and they had to bring in another contractor to complete the project, and they didn't have the funds to adequately complete the work as designed by Perry Dean Rogers Architects. So that back door, they had a different design for that door, and it wasn't executed. And I believe they had Karis and Karis glass that put in the Water Street door vestibule that was shown. I believe they just, they fabricated the other doors for that opening just as an inexpensive way to secure the back of the building.
Okay, so you're confident that the new door will adhere to any requirements of the preservation restriction, it sounds like?
Yes.
Okay, great, thank you.
Yeah, this is Glenn Richards, and as I can confirm that, yeah, we did review this at the Historical Commission a while back, and you're quite right in that a lot of these changes are significant enough that they would need review and approval, but we did give the approval either because they were actually aesthetic and historical improvements, or they were really necessary for the preservation of both the building and the collection. Thanks.
Thanks, Glenn. Greg, a quick question for you. is the water tightness of the roof, does that include the portico in the front on the water street?
No, it does not. Okay. Actually, that's one of the priorities that I've identified in the current assessment. That has, that roof has a flat lock, lead coated copper covering that was installed in 1973, and it's leaking. And the leaking is starting to damage it's damaging the interior wood finish. I'm not sure what the condition of the substrate beneath that roof is. And we're gonna open up that ceiling, hopefully to look at that, hopefully sooner than later.
Is that something that should be addressed prior to installation of the new door or the restored door?
I think that they can be done. I think the doors can be restored and they can be protected when they do the other work.
Okay.
We've been working on taking on incremental projects that, you know, taking small bites and raising funds to chip away at some of the chronic issues that the building has suffered from. So the doors seem like the most important thing for us currently because of the, you know, looking at completing the entire building envelope and addressing the moisture and heat loss issues for the building. We're also looking at doing some more work on the windows, the self facade on Water Street. Those actually are the original 1872 windows with some modifications. And those all are leaking. There was solar film that was put on them in 2003. Then the film has lost its adhesion and they've bubbled, and we'd like to have that removed and have those windows weather sealed as well. So there is a list of projects that we're doing. Again, we've sort of broken things up into smaller phases so that we can, you know, get work done.
Okay. Well, thank you. Any Jane Healy, you still have a question? Nope. Okay.
No, sorry, I'm set.
All righty. Anybody else? Okay, Andy, do you have any members of the public with hands raised?
I'll give a moment. We do have Tom Coltijohn.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, Tom.
Tom Coltijohn, 64 Federal Street, co-president of the Newburyport Preservation Trust. All I would like to do is speak in favor of this project. There's been significant progress to improve this wonderful historic building, and I applaud them for carrying on. So whatever support that you can give them, it would be most appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
I do not see any other hands raised at this time.
Okay, then thank you, Greg, and the presenters. We'll move on to the next project. Which is the Cushing House Landscape Restoration Phase 3 from the Historical Society of Old Newbury, requesting $45,717. And let's see. Presenting is Susan Edwards.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Susan, thank you.
Great, thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the Community Preservation Committee for past support, both for our landscape and for our structures. And this would be the third and final landscape restoration and rehabilitation phase. The slide before you now is a plan that was done in 1936 of the Cushing House property. With the carriage path, which is one of the projects for this proposal, to the right of the lower square, and then also behind the barn at the top, the orchard slash nursery garden. Next, please. As you can see, this is very similar to the last slide I just showed. This is based on the 1936 HABS Historic American Building Survey Plan, and it was done by Landscape Elements in 2016. We received a grant from the Mass Historical Commission to create a preservation plan for the entire landscape at the Cushing House. Next, please. This is the first part of this two-part project is for the carriage drive. In 1867, John Cushing Jr. Purchased the property adjacent, which is now 20 Fruit Street, to the Cushing House, rotated the carriage barn 90 degrees, and then shortly thereafter sold the property, but he got the land that he wanted, both the carriage path and the orchard garden, to provide access to the 1808 carriage barn. So what you see here is both grass and cobblestone areas. Our plan is to provide drainage in this area on the right, which is adjacent to 20 Fruit Street, and relay all of the granite on the left-hand side as well. And the driveway itself would be a combination of cobblestone and grass. So we would salvage all of, clean and salvage all of the cobblestone. And then once it has a new base for it, it would be relaid. So that basically you'd be seeing the same thing that you are today, but with a system that would provide restoration of it and less fluctuation than it has had over the last many decades. Next slide, please. So here's an actual view from Fruit Street up to the carriage barn. One of the things that would be included in this proposal is removing the granite and doing grading, again, as well as drainage, and resetting that granite apron. Also on this side, the left-hand side, which is the back of the privy and the laundry shed all the way up to the barn, and then drainage on the right. Next slide, please. This gives you a little bit closer view of the current pattern of the cobblestones and granite that are there. And we have found out in the last year that there is actually a great deal more cobble than just at the top of the drive, but it goes down considerably. So we would follow that original pattern of replacing the cobble entrance. Next slide, please. This is the access into the carriage barn. We are proposing to remove the bulkhead and also to remove the ramp that you see into the barn, which is rotted and which is a hazard. The bulkhead is no longer functional, so that would allow us to provide drainage and cobblestone all the way up to the barn itself. Next slide, please. And this is the treatment plan for that whole area, showing a close-up of the bulkhead. One of the problems that has occurred over the last few decades is that it has been causing drainage issues. The fence and the granite wall underneath it received substantial damage. And this past fall and winter, we went ahead with funds from donors and some of the museum's funds to replace the fence and the granite wall. Next slide, please. The granite wall was seriously undermined and in danger of collapse. So this is work that's been completed that we would normally have applied to the CPC for, but we don't need to do that. It has focused our work on the actual carriage drive itself. Next slide, please. And in addition to the new granite wall, this fence, a mahogany fence, based on the original was installed. The metal poles will be cased also with mahogany boxes, and it will be painted white as it was originally. But you can see from this slide a great deal of cobblestones at the bottom as well as what was at the top. So that is guiding our work to restore it as much as rehabilitate it. Also on the left-hand side, you can see a fence that is leaning inward. And that's actually part of the project for last year's CPC grant to do the cobble courtyard on the other side of the fence, and then to replace that fence matching the original and with a gate that will open into the cobble courtyard. So this area is important because it not only provides access to the carriage barn, but also to the courtyard, which will be used for public programming. Next slide, please. So now we move on to the orchard and nursery area. And this is the treatment plan from 2016 done by Landscape Elements. Again, some of this work has already been done and does not appear in our grant proposal. The existing trees that presented the hazard and the liability have been removed. The cobble and granite walkway is still in poor condition. The lawn areas have been partially reconditioned. The perimeter fencing has not been handled and is in very poor condition. Some of it will be rebuilt and some of it will be replaced, matching the original. And then at the last item there is to screen the new utilities. With CPC funding, we installed an HVAC split pump system in the Perkins Printing and Engraving building. And the air exchange system for those is to the left of that building. And so what we're proposing is to build a small lattice work in exclosures so that they won't be seen by the public. Next slide, please. So here you actually see the path. It's the only access at this point to the Perkins Mint. Previously, we had a temporary easement through 18 Fruit Street, but since the sale of that building, the driveway has been completely regraded and there is no access from 18 Fruit Street any longer. So this is the only access for exhibitions and programming in this building. You can see on the left, the fence that had collapsed, that would be the one that would be rebuilt. But the primary focus here is the cobblestone, brick, and granite path. Our proposal is to, again, salvage all of the cobblestone and reuse it after it's cleaned, provide the base for it so there will not be freeze and thaw issues, and to double the width of the granite path so that it will be ADA accessible, as the cobble courtyard will be after that work is complete this summer. Next slide, please. Here you can see how it has been undermined. This is a close-up of the top of the path behind the barn. So it's actually almost impossible to see the brick here, but it does exist to the side of the cobblestone. Next slide, please. The gardens have been restored over the last 2.5 to 3 years so that as I said earlier, a lot of the grading of the lawn has been done. This gives you a good view of the fence that would need to be replaced, but again, matching the original 1936 design that had been there for probably decades before that, when the Cushing family still were inhabiting the house. And we would also reset the bricks once the path is widened. Next slide, please. Another view of the fence, which leads from the orchard and nursery garden to the Perkins Mint. As I said, that's all been redone now so that there's actually a brick path into the Perkins Mint that's six spans of brick wide rather than the three that you see there. But the perimeter fence needs to be replaced. Next slide, please. And this is the final slide, which shows the split pump system for the HVAC. And we're proposing to put a lattice enclosure around that so that it will not be unsightly when people access the Perkins Mint. And I'm happy to answer any questions that anybody might have.
Thank you, Susan. Any questions from the committee members? Okay. I don't see any.
I have a comment.
Okay, Don?
So the applicant is requesting 50% of their budget, and on page four under project timeline, the application states commitments of matching funds will be in hand by July 2021. Although we realize that CPC funds do not require a match, the museum feels that it is important to leverage city funds to raise additional income from other sources. I think many of our other applicants also do this. They request funds from other sources, but I just thought this was worded very well and I just wanted to highlight it.
Thanks, Don. Any other questions or comments from the committee?
Yeah, hi, Michael Glenn again. Just a real quick comment. Like the as with the Custom House, this property is also under a preservation restriction, as you all probably know. And this project was also had been already reviewed by the Historical Commission for their okay on it.
And it was approved, right?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Good. Thanks, Glenn.
I'd like to just add one more comment, Mike.
Sure, Susan.
The work that was done on the carriage drive with the granite wall and the new fence, we submitted a proposal to the Fruit Street Historic District Commission, and so that was approved by them.
Great, thank you. Anyone else? Okay, Andy, any members of the public with hands raised?
We do have Tom Calderjohn.
Okay. Tom, you have the floor again.
Tom Calderjohn, 64 Federal Street, co-president of the Newburyport Preservation Trust. This is a delightful project and the trust fully supports it. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Thanks, Tom. And next person we have is, I think it's Joan from the Custom House.
Yes, thank you. Susan, I apologize. I was raising my hand after my the presentation for the Customs House, and I just wanted to go on the record. So I don't want to steal your thunder because I really do support the Cushing House landscape restoration. But I just wanted to put in a plug of for support for the Customs House in the sense that the doors, I know that the agenda has some really important critical issues to fund. And I just wanted to say that with the door project, you know, these are two wide openings of a very important building. And I would invite anybody on a nor'easter day to come and not only see the interior vestibule doors move, even though the front doors are closed, you know, I mean, there is just constant air coming in and the basement level and the first floor monitoring the temperature is significantly colder because of not being able to continue to get a good seal. So I just wanted to really say that, you know, both doors are very critical, but I agree with Greg and having to prioritize at a time like this, that I would also advocate that the back doors are critical. So again, my apology to Susan and to the committee, but I just wanted to make sure I got on the record for the support of the Customs House. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Okay, well, thank you, Susan.
Thank you.
Okay. We have no other hands raised.
So. Okay, no other hands raised. Moving along then, Garrison Birthplace Signage in Garrison Gardens. Newburyport Preservation Trust requesting $3,694. And I believe Tom Coulterjohn is presenting.
Tom Coulterjohn, 64 Federal Street, co-president of the Newburyport Preservation Trust. Good evening. I would like to make one correction or change to the application. The Newburyport Bank has graciously awarded the trust a matching grant of $1,872.50. So I'd like to cut our CPC request in half. We'd be thrilled if we could get, well, we were awarded $1,800. This first slide, number seven, is a perfect place to start. The proposed project is to research, create, and install two interpretive signs in the Garrison Gardens section of Atwood Park. It's directly across the street from the 18th century house, 3-5 School Street, which is the birthplace of William Lloyd Garrison. If we could go back to seven for just a minute, please. Andy?
My apologies, Tom. I had thought the reference might be appropriate. Sorry.
Thank you. In the top, you see the Atwood Park in the green, and on the left-hand side in the sort of the L in the upper section, that's Garrison Gardens, which is directly across from the Garrison House. So the Garrison House, I don't know if you can read it in this, but it's 19-32 in the on this map here, on the assessor's map. Andy, could we go to slide 28, please? This is the style of the sign. These are common throughout Newburyport along the rail trail. We have them up at the Powder House. This one happens to be a larger one. The newer ones tend to be a bit smaller. We are proposing that we put in two smaller ones, approximately 18 by 24 inches. And we think that we could get a good amount of information on both of the signs. Andy, if you could go to slide 24, please. As I'm sure you may know, Garrison was a Newburyport native son who became an important abolitionist, journalist, and suffragist. When he lived here, he was not always welcome, so strong were his beliefs. Today, he is one of Newburyport's favorite sons. The trust's interest in Garrison was piqued when the developer bought the property and architect Scott Brown asked us to work with him to do justice to the building. This is how it looked before restoration. The trust spent countless hours going over minute details with the architect on how the building's exterior should look. At one point, I remember getting up on my roof to measure the chimney for comparison of what it might be and what it should be for a circa 1750 house. We loaned the architect actual 18th century windows so the size and the profiles could be copied. The interior had long been previously gutted and remodeled, I guess would be the more appropriate. In its current condition was in tough shape inside and out. I'm not sure that even Garrison would have recognized his old home. In the end, after seeing the earlier photos, we decided that it should be brought back. So if we could go to slide 23, please, Andy. Thank you. This photo is from the Museum of Old Newbury, and it dates from around 1890, if I remember correctly. It's clearly a scented chimney Georgian building. Macris, which is the state historic buildings listing, dates the house at about 1750. And that looks about right. As part of the project, the trust will contribute researching the history of this house. While he was born in 1805, this is more likely what he would have known the house to look like. So we tried to get back to this. If you could go, Andy, if you could go to slide 25, please, I'd appreciate it. So this is what the house looks like today. I hope all of you had a chance to attend the William Lloyd Garrison inaugural lecture, which was put on by the Trust Next Generation Preservationists last December. It was on Zoom, hosted by the Newburyport Public Library. Panelists included Max Clement of the Next Generation Preservationists, Mayor Holliday, and editor Richard Lodge of the Daily News also presented. It was inspiring, to say the least. We learned about the original research done by scholar Kate Clifford Larson. It focused on the enduring friendship between Garrison's extended family and Harriet Tubman's work against slavery. It was clear from this respected scholar and the panelists that not enough has been done to celebrate Garrison and to make known his accomplishments. In addition, there has been intense public interest by members of the trust and others in both Garrison and in educating citizens and visitors alike about him. Based on that interest, we thought that interpretive signs would help. The two primary goals of the proposed project are: one, to educate the public about William Lloyd Garrison and his accomplishments, and two, to identify the importance of his birthplace to the city, the Commonwealth, and yes, even the nation. Andy, could I have slide 26, please? This is the view from the far corner of Garrison Gardens. The two signs would be placed roughly in this corner within the park, so that people could read the interpretive signs and be able to look right at Garrison's birthplace. Dr. Larson has agreed to write the text for the signs, and the trust, as I mentioned, is in the process of researching the Garrison house itself, so that we have more information that could be placed on the second sign. I think the cost on this project is minimal, but the benefit is significant. I would be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Any questions or comments from the committee? Don Little.
If I recall correctly, when the interpretive panels were installed at Brown Square years ago, I think they started to peel soon after. I think the new manufacturer, whoever we're going with, that problem's been solved, but just caution to make sure we don't go with that same supplier or whatever the issue was.
Thank you for that. I'm aware of the problem, and we don't want that problem.
Any other questions? Tom O'Brien.
I don't have a question. I just have a statement that I grew up across the street from Garrison's house, and now I've been in there many, many times with people who used to live there from around 1946 to 1964. And then I came back 2 years ago and saw the sign gone. And I said, Jesus, when is the city gonna do something for William Lloyd, my hero? But so I'm wholly support this. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Any other questions or comments from the committee? Andy, do you have any members of the public with hands raised?
Just give a moment. We don't have much of an attendance at this hour, but doesn't look like it at this time. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Tom. That concludes our review of the applications. I believe because the final application, it was originally on the schedule, the shipbuilding memorial phase one was withdrawn by the applicant. Okay. I don't have any updates to report, just to comment that in the package that was circulated to the committee, we do have some quarterly reports. We do have an updated budget that we're looking at, which we will get further detail in advance of our May meeting in terms of nailing down what the available funds are. And other than that, Andy, does the planning director have anything to report?
No, I don't think anything of note at this point. Like you said, just your to prepare maybe for your meeting in May, 26th of May for, ranking, selection, recommendations and whatnot. And if there are any additional questions you might have between now and then, if you could just communicate those to Caitlin, she'll reach out to applicants if that's, whatever the question is, she'll follow up accordingly and see if we can get additional information. But hopefully the applicants have been thorough.
Right. And Caitlin will also circulate a worksheet like we had last year with the it's like a spreadsheet where you can fill in the blanks as you're considering your own rankings of the projects and amounts that you plan to propose recommending or not. That'll be in advance of our May meeting, which will be the 26th, 7 p.m. And the sole item on that agenda at this moment is our review of all of the applications, discussion, and then voting on them for recommendations. I'd like to, we have in the package the minutes of March 24. I'd like to have a motion for approval.
I move approval of those minutes.
Okay. And a second?
Second.
Okay, that's Tom O'Brien seconded. Any questions, comments, corrections? Okay, thank you. Then we'll have a roll call vote on the on the approval of the minutes, and it will be followed by a motion to adjourn the meeting. So why don't we do that with a single roll call, okay? You can answer twice. The first one is the minutes, the second one is the adjournment. Okay, Jane Healy.
Yes and yes.
Chuck Griffin.
Aye.
Don Little.
Yes, twice.
Paul Healy.
Yes, yes.
Tom O'Brien.
Yes, yes.
Mark Rosen. Mark, you still with us? It's not. Glenn Richards.
Yeah, yes and yes. And I should point out for the minute ticker for tonight that I joined the meeting at approximately 8 p.m. Sorry about that.
That's okay. And the chair votes yes and yes. Okay, we will I'll see you all again on May 26th.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're adjourned.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.